like any other kid, James Harding had a loving family and a nice life in the burbs. Nothing was remarkable. So how does a young man like this end up in the thick of Melbourne's underworld? Well, James the Hammer Harding is here with us now. Welcome to the show. Before we chat
to him
and get him to answer some of those questions, let's take a look at some of his story.
James Harding was a ruthless, violent rogue. He was trying to fill a hole that was created when he was a 15-year-old. He was chasing significance and power, and he thought violence was going to get him back to the kid he lost. I was very wrong about that.
James was coming home from a party one night when he and his mate were attacked in the street.
I couldn't actually get up, I was too scared. The repercussions of that, my best mate was sort of hacked to pieces. And I carried the coward badge from that moment on because I wasn't able to do anything about it. I started creating this character, the Hammer, as a young bloke. I was going to be really protective of my friends going forward and anyone around me.
This character inside James's mind became very real, and it led him down a path where he was rolling with some of Melbourne's most dangerous criminals.
I realised that I could push the envelope a little bit now because I couldn't see anything worse happening. I went looking for these characters, these really dangerous sort of characters.
James was a notorious standover man, collecting debts for his criminal bosses.
In that world, you have to pay someone, otherwise you're going to get it. If I didn't sort out the situation and get payment, I was going to have to answer to someone. I overdosed by myself one night in my flat. I started taking drugs really early in the day, which wasn't uncommon. But this day I had a little bit of extra venom in my step. I was laying on my bed and I was in a bit of trouble, and I saw something like a dark entity come in the doorway, and he stared at me, and I perceived it probably as a Grim Reaper, but he just waved his finger at me, and I put the emergency prayer upstairs and said, if you get me out of this one, I'll spend the rest of my life helping people.
Wow. Great piece there by Luke Broadley, our producer. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having
me. What an extraordinary life and journey you've taken. Can you describe for us what you were actually doing when you were working as a standover man in the underworld?
Yeah, so it was all, it all revolved around drugs, whether you're collecting money, dropping product off, and occasionally I'd collect debts for really what we call straighties. Mm. That was fun because... you'd get someone that'd try to take advantage of an honest person, and I'd do that as a favour and go and collect the money for them. Or
what do you mean trying to take advantage of an honest person?
Yeah, so sometimes, like for example, a restaurateur I knew was not paying his fresh produce supplier.
Right.
So
you're almost a Robin Hood in a bit of a way.
Dark Robin Hood, yeah, yeah.
So you could actually feel good about what was pretty bad work.
Sometimes, yeah, I did a couple of good things for really good people.
Mm. We all know, obviously, people come from rough upbringings. It's very easy to get hooked into a life of crime, but you had a pretty average upbringing. How did it turn for you? Was it just that moment you spoke about, or was there something else going on?
Yeah, well, I was born an addict. Only something I've worked out recently, and always very hyperactive and needed to chase adventure and adrenaline. And when I was 15, as that mentioned there, me and a mate were walking home from a party.
Yeah.
Were randomly attacked with swords. I wasn't drunk, so I sort of walked back and fell over a fence and was laying in the garden bed as they turned on my mate and they just hacked him to pieces, and I was laying in the garden bed, and I wanted to get up and, you know, be the hero, but I was so scared.
Did your mate survive?
Yeah.
You're only 15.
15, yeah.
That's not an old age to be facing somebody that's hacking somebody to death.
Yeah, I know. It's tricky, but your mind doesn't work that way. Mm. Anyway, I laid there, and when I got up, he came at me, and it was just blood.
Wow.
Everywhere, and... I sort of thought to myself, I'm not going to be on the receiving end of this, and I felt like a real coward, and a couple of people that I was friends with might have said a couple of things to me, and I just, it was like a burden. It was this rock that I carried on my shoulders, and I promised myself I was going to be the most fierce.
Being a tough guy is incredibly important for a teenage boy. Like, it's on top of everything. Yeah. Just seem to be tough. When you were speaking there, you were speaking about yourself in the third person as though James Harding was sort of someone else.
Yeah.
Is that how you feel?
Now? Yeah, definitely. It seems like, I mean, even writing the book, I just can't believe that I did those things.
Mm. You sort of described almost making a conscious decision to go into that world.
Yep.
How then did you make the decision to come back out of it, and how did you do it?
It's funny, before I started properly rocking and rolling in Melbourne, I set an end date of 25.
Did you?
Yeah. I thought I'll get as much experience as I can in 5 years, and I stuck to that. At 25, I pulled the pin and moved up the coast. Yeah.
And recovered from
your Yeah, so I did the recovery the hard way. It's called white knuckling in addiction terms. I saw a whole bunch of... I did the holistic thing and wanted to, rather than take a drug to mask an emotional problem, I wanted to understand how my body and mind worked and look at it from a big picture. And I went to all sorts of healers and kinesiologists and acupuncturists and... But ultimately, all healing is self-healing. Like, you've got to really want it.
Can I ask something? You talk about the healing being self-healing, right?
Yep.
How long did it take to forgive yourself?
Probably 10 years, mate.
Wow.
10 years. The book was...
That's obviously cathartic, right? Like, that's part of your therapy, is writing about it. It's your kind of way of...
Yep. Yeah, that was probably the full stop on that. And I still continually do work on my self-worth. Mm. And it always comes...
But that hate of yourself took 10 years.
Oh, I wouldn't say I ever hated myself. But, 10 years of trying and failing, trying and failing. I just never gave up.
Mm. Now, you've got a beautiful wife and 5 children.
5 children.
Wow.
Does the old James ever surface?
Yeah, that's a good question. I thought I'd put the aggression away, but I was soon to find out when someone threatens the safety of your family, well, it was like that.
Mm.
And it's a lot more controlled now. But, there were three instances about a year and a half ago when a guy nearly ran over my daughter driving on the road illegally. And I felt that this guy needed to understand never to do that again. Mm. So he pulled over and I broke his window to get at him. And his window was in his lap and I just said to him, "You nearly killed my daughter." And he drove off with his window in his lap. Yes. And I'm pretty sure he'll never do that again.
But is that a standover man, or is that just what any dad would do in that situation?
Yeah. It's funny. I've wrestled with it because my kids sort of heard it,
and they can't.
They always talk about it.
Is this kind of, you've got an organisation called Hard Cuddles?
Correct.
Was that? I mean, obviously, is your history the premise behind it, or is it kind of your history or your desire to do good now?
Desire to do good. I remember thinking, I wish I had, during my times that I was really struggling, I remember wishing I had someone like I am now.
Yeah.
Mm. Someone to turn to. So with all these healers and all these different people I worked with to help me, I sort of started picking and choosing stuff. I thought, this is applicable to men.
Mm.
And then, when I made the call, I thought I'm as well experienced as anyone to be able to help men.
You've been through everything.
Yeah. In a lot of ways, yeah.
Before we let you go, what do you mean by Hard Cuddles? What's that all about?
Yeah, my daughter rang me one morning on the phone and said to me, "We give hard cuddles, don't we, Dad?" And I thought, yeah, that's the name of the business. So, the foundation, it's just, look, men still need to have that, it's not macho, they need to have that solidarity and strength. But you can still be able to cuddle and vulnerability as a man with a bit of strength.
Well, James is the founder of Hard Cuddles, which is his program helping addicts recover. And he also has a book out that goes by the same name. Hold it up, give it a plug. If you're interested in taking part in James's programs, visit hardcuddles.com.au. It's been great chatting with you. Thanks for stopping by, James.
Thank you very much. Thank you.